currently watching us on television while he recovers from surgery, so we wish him a Merry Christmas.
Our one viewer.
Ms. Austin?
Here.
Mr. Houchens?
Here.
Mr. Thomas?
Here.
And Mr. Fraley?
Here. Thank you, Lenny. We'll proceed with our continued agenda.
All right. We have on the continued agenda, we have requests from continued item number one, the Lagoon, for a special exception to operate an entertainment establishment with alcoholic beverages on property located at 9500 30th Bay Street. And we have from regular item number three, which is the Virginia United Methodist Home, which is the Lydia H. Roper Home for property located at 113 through 127 East 40th Street. Those applications have been requested a continuance to the January public hearing. The motion, therefore, is to continue the items for the public hearing to be held on Thursday, January 22nd, 2015, at 2:30 p.m. in the City Council Chambers, 11th floor, City Hall Building, Civic Center, Norfolk, Virginia. Dr. Newman?
Aye.
Ms. McQuillan?
Yes.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchens?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
All right, that's going to take us. I'm sorry.
I said thank you.
All right. That takes us to the regular agenda. We will open with item number one by Edward McCullough. For the following applications, number A, it's an amendment to the city's future land use map within the general plan, Norfolk Plan Norfolk 2030 from commercial to multifamily, and B, a text amendment to the city's zoning ordinance to amend section 10-13, Courtney Avenue, Urban Multiple Use District, in order to revise the development standards for the district.
Thank you, Lenny. And here to speak in favor of that application is the applicant, Mr. Edward McCullough.
Do we need him to speak?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, good afternoon. Edward McCullough, 1406 Eleanor Court, Norfolk, Virginia. Thank you for your time this afternoon. I am representing the applicant, and we are proposing to build 155 market-rate apartments at this site. Why are we revising this? Is we were the original folks that came in with the planned use development rezoning a few years ago. It might even have been 5 years ago now. And we were only contemplating the rehabilitation of the historic structure that was on the front of the site that faced East Princess Anne. Since then, it has evolved that we have acquired the entire site, and we'd like to develop. We're redeveloping that building still, and we are developing a new 64-unit building on the back part of the site, proposing that.
No.
The number of unit changes in the historic building from 72 to 91 is a result of we had a mix of one and two bedrooms in the historic structure initially. Now we've gone to all one bedrooms, so we actually have less bedrooms we're proposing for the historic structure. And then we are proposing all two- and three-bedroom units in the new structure that we will construct. I think it's important to point out that these will be market-rate apartments. Both buildings will, both structures will. They will be under the same ownership umbrella, the same on-site management program that will be on-site that you saw in the clubhouse and management offices, the common area for the two residential buildings. I guess I just want to see if you got any questions I can answer for you.
You've used the term market rate a couple of times.
The market rate, yes, sir.
What does market rate mean to you?
What market rate means to me is, and this can be, you know, in a submarket, in a smaller city. I grew up in Maryland many moons ago in the outside suburbs, and your markets there didn't change a whole lot. You'd have sort of a 5 mile or a 10 mile radius. In smaller cities, where I've lived for 15 years here now, that submarket or market can change within a half a mile or a mile. So market rate, what that means to me is what that market, that geographic market, will bear. There are no income restrictions. There are no voucher restrictions. There are no rental restrictions, actually, whatsoever. It is just like any other projects. We've done some projects downtown. We're starting a couple other projects on the north part of downtown. It's the same definition there in that market or that submarket. We actually call all of what we do sort of a submarket, is what the market will bear in rents. So the rents here will range anywhere from $725 to a little under $1,200. $1,190, I think, is my range on the markets. But no restrictions. That's really maybe the big one, is there aren't any income restrictions on them, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. McCullough, there's a site plan attached with the documents you submitted. Is it a condition that the site plan will be attached to the zoning? Have you agreed to that?
Yes, and we have provided Ms. Pollock with the updated engineered one that we've provided. And really, it only changed because we put the enclosed dumpster enclosures, and we added part of the original structure. The 1903 structure was also a little wing of a boiler building that we did not have on that example, but we do have on our engineering plan. So those are really the only two differences. But yes, we will proffer that site plan is what we are going to do as part of this.
Okay.
Any other questions of Mr. McCullough, commissioners?
No.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all.
Yeah. Chair, we entertain a motion.
The motion is to recommend that the general plan amendment and the zoning text amendment be approved as described at the public hearing. Dr. Newman?
Aye.
Ms. McQuillan?
Yes.
Mr. Hodgins?
Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation to council, and good luck with that project.
All right. The next application before you is a request by the City of Norfolk for the following applications. A change of zoning from C2 Corridor Commercial to D2 Downtown Regional Center on property locating 470 feet, more or less, along the southern line of East Butte Street, 289 feet, more or less, along the western line of Fenchurch Street, and 223 feet, more or less, along the northern line of Wood Street, premises numbered 523 through 545 East Butte, 555 Fenchurch, and 520 Wood Street. B, to close Fox Lane from the eastern line of Posey Lane to the southern line of East Butte Street. And C, to close Posey Lane from the southern line of East Butte Street to the northern line of Wood Street.
Thank you, Lenny. Here to speak in favor of this application is Reverend Burton.
We need that presentation.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Excuse me, Reverend Burton. I preempted you just 1 minute, sir. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon. The request that you have before you is for rezoning and street closures. The property that we are discussing today is actually a full block. It is bounded on the north by East Butte Street, on the south by Wood Street, on the east by Fenchurch, and on the west by Posey Lane. The site is currently developed with a church, which is on the north portion of the site, and then the remainder of the land is vacant. The request is, there's two requests, actually. There's a rezoning, and that would cover the entire block, as well as the closures of both Posey Lane and Fox Lane, which you can see on the arrow that you're looking at. Fox Lane is the one that runs horizontal, and then Posey is just to the west of that, running north-south. The bigger picture. In 2006... the city acquired parcels in this block, the L-shaped parcel that is not owned by the church. The city did acquire that. In addition to that, there is an entire block located just to the west of this site on the other side of Posey Lane that the city acquired. Together, these lots that the city owned as well as the church-owned property is just over 5 acres. What the request is that the zoning be changed from C2, which is corridor commercial, to D2. The lot that I mentioned that the city acquired just to the west, that is currently zoned D2. So in essence, this request would carry that D2 zoning, which is a downtown zoning district, onto this lot that both the city and the church owns. What is the difference between a C2 and a D2? Generally, there's some use differences in a C2 district. Residential is allowed only as a mixed use, and it is by special exception. In a D2 district, that would be permitted outright. Some development standards that are a little bit different. In the C2 district, there is a height limit. And in the D2 district, it's really based on a floor area ratio. It's basically proportional to the size of the site. Also, parking requirements are a bit different. In a C2, the parking is specifically tied to the use. And in the D2 districts, there are no parking requirements for any uses. And there are also some setback requirements. Generally in D2, because it is more urban, you see setbacks that are encourage development closer to the street. And again, part of the request would be to close the two lanes, Fox and Posey. And those are the street closures. The rezoning would basically bring together these two blocks to create a 5-plus acre site. And as that request, the city is recommending that that be approved. It is a straightforward rezoning. It is not conditional, is not tied to a site plan. But by extending this D2 to the site, you do create a larger development site. Development of this site could be a catalyst for more development in this area. I do also want to mention that we have been made aware of, we had an applicant make a presentation to our architectural review board on Monday. And our understanding is that we do have a proposal that would propose 120 multifamily units. It would be a tax credit project, and it would consist of several four-story buildings on the site for the multifamily. Again, this is a straightforward rezoning, so there isn't a site plan per se attached to it. It is straightforward D2 zoning. Any questions?
Any questions, Ms. Pollard, commissioners? Comment at this time? Thank you, Susan. I'm sorry, Ms. Austin, go ahead.
There is no site plan, as you said, connected with this.
We have a survey of the property that was attached, so it's not conditional, so it's not conditioned to a site plan.
But if I'm right, and my fellow commissioners can comment upon this, it is usual to have one.
So. As you saw in the application before, there was a site plan proffered.
Right, and this doesn't come upon. This is part of, I understand, the St. Paul development for that community.
Which is a plan that I believe the Planning Commission has looked at and approved, but I don't think has received approval from City Council.
Oh, okay. But it does represent quite an extensive public participation in looking at the future development for this area.
Right, and as Paula could probably speak to it better than I. She has worked on it for most of her career here, but I think she would say that would be a fair statement.
It's so, and this development, what does that represent for this area? It's essentially the first out of the gate, is it not?
Yes, it would be. And again, the D2 itself would be in keeping with the St. Paul's plan.
I'm a little concerned that it's not connected. We don't know exactly. I mean, you've made some general statements about what this would be like, and if it's a 5-acre plan, it's kind of creating a super block, is it not? In this area, 5-acre plan.
It's a large block. Correct. Yes.
What kind of this? From what you know at this point. What kind of community would this create in this 5-acre setting?
I mean, again, it not being tied to a site plan, the development of it is the exact details of the development is unknown at this point, other than there is this potential development opportunity out there that we don't know all the details of.
I would say the concern that I would have, having looked at that and being very excited about it, actually, the plan is the public hearings had articulated, that it would be very important to really understand what this is going to do. So those are my comments for the record. I'm a bit concerned that we are not seeing anything for a project that actually would be quite important.
Susan, let me just amplify by asking the question. You indicated that the St. Paul Quadrant study was not blessed by City Council as a guiding light for this particular area, but is it not included in the comprehensive plan?
I think there, yeah, were parts of it included in the plan, correct.
All right, which was blessed by council.
Correct.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Any other questions of Susan, commissioners, comment? To what extent can you share with us, Susan, the 120-unit complex that was proposed to the Architectural Review Board?
And honestly, I've told you about all I know. It was 120 units. My understanding is that I believe the buildings are on the edge of the site, with the parking being both beside and behind them. It is a tax credit program, and it's four-story buildings.
Mm-hmm. And parking being surface parking, I assume
surface
you mean.
Surface parking, mm-hmm. Correct.
Mr. Chairman,
yes, ma'am.
I just had some, my concerns, one of my key areas has been to study issues regarding recurrent flooding, tidal flooding, stormwater, retention, and without having a plan in place, knowing the extreme conditions of this area, it's very concerning to me not to have a plan to approve the rezoning. So I think this is great, and I want to hear from everybody here, but I think that there's a lot of good information, and it's exciting to see that somebody is interested in this area. I will say that. So that's a positive.
Any other questions to Susan? Comment, commissioners? Thank you, Susan. Reverend Burton, sorry to delay you, sir. We would ask that we keep our comments to 3 minutes if at all possible. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I will do my best as a preacher to keep 3 minutes.
Appreciate you.
My name is John Burton. I serve as the senior pastor of Historic St. John's AME Church, which is the oldest black congregation in downtown, standing in the same place in the city of Norfolk. I stand now in support of both the closing of Posey Lane and Fox Lane. I stand for that, but also for the change in the zoning. One of the issues, or the major issues that have been at St. John's over the years, even going back to where we park at, has been that there we do not have land for parking. Mm-hmm. If this is allowed to be rezoned and also Fox Lane closed, then we will have ample parking for the next 100 years. If not, then we will still be in the same position that we're in. And one of the considerations is that most of the black African Americans move from downtown into the suburbs. So most of my congregation, probably about 90%, drive in. And certainly if at what time anything is built downtown and the parking is taken away, then it's certainly going to affect or even totally close my congregation out. So with this zoning change, the possibility of us having some parking, plus I think it would improve the area. And then the other thing is that I'm glad that y'all are concerned about that side of St. Paul, because up until now it seems you haven't. They put a bus station right to my back door without any help from me or even anything from me. They just put it there. So I'm glad to see that y'all do have some concerns on that side, and I'm hoping the concerns of the parking for St. John's will be one of those concerns so that you might, if you would, please change that zoning for us. Thank you very much.
Let me clarify one thing for you. There are at least two members of this commission who spoke out very adamantly against that bus station, but that doesn't help you too much right now.
But I didn't have a chance to speak to it at all, sir. I was not even told. It was not part of. I started with this master plan. Give me one more minute. I started with this master plan with Mr. Duke in the city of Norfolk, I guess probably 8 or 10 years ago.
I recall.
And we had a plan in place, and half of what's going on that side of St. Paul St. Paul Boulevard is not what we planned, what we set out and we agreed to say that was going to take place. Most of it has totally went another way. for whatever reasons, at times without even notifying us. I'm glad she's concerned, Sister Austin is concerned about the community. But a lot of what happened in that community and around my church, I don't think y'all have been concerned. If so, you haven't expressed it to me. And I am one of the stakeholders there. And then also please remember that part of my congregation live in Tidewater Garden. They're members of my church, full members. Mm-hmm. So I would just appreciate it if y'all would allow this to go ahead on and take place so that we can feel comfortable. It was unanimous by the congregation at St. John's that we make this request.
Thank you, sir.
May I ask one more question?
Yes, ma'am.
You spoke only of the closing of Fox Lane?
But also Posey.
And also Posey.
Yes, ma'am. It would be both of them. In order for us to maybe possibly receive and to get parking, it would necessitate closing both of those. Mm-hmm. It's only halfway across this building that you're closing. I mean, by looking at it on the map, it looks like it's some long street. But I can run all the way around the church in less than a minute myself at age 70. So it's not that much. It's going to be closed.
Reverend Burton, how many spaces would you gain?
We would probably gain anywhere from 40 to 50 spaces. Mm-hmm. Well, 35 to 45 spaces. And if you're wondering what we have now, presently we have only 22 parking spaces mm-hmm. at the church. Mm-hmm. And Mrs. Williams, the former city manager, allowed us to park on that vacant land behind us until at such time as the city would do something with it.
Is that still available to you?
No one has told us not to park, so I didn't come down and ask.
Okay. Smart man.
I was born at night, but it wasn't last night.
We thank you. Any questions of Reverend Burton, commissioners?
Chairman.
Mr. Reverend Burton, if you would, we have another question.
That's okay. Reverend Burton, are you familiar with the St. Paul's quadrant study?
I am probably as familiar with it as most. I started out with Mr. Duke, I think, with the city of Norfolk. And that was from the very beginning. That was at the start of all of this. And so I'm pretty familiar with what we planned, what was planned by the city to take place over there. But what I was saying, sir, is that I think some of the things that the city had presented to us that were planned for over there are not necessarily the things that are going to take place over there.
Right. So would you say that the current proposed rezoning ties in or conflicts with what was initially suggested or thought of as far as you being a stakeholder there in the community?
I think it would tie in very well for the simple fact that part of the original plan that we started out with, it was for multi-family housing and also apartments and all kinds of things over there. That was the original plan in the beginning. I have no idea what the city plans to do now.
Do you see any potential negative impact that it might have?
It won't have any negative impact well, as a matter of fact, I see one positive impact. They're building a bus terminal that was never supposed to be built downtown Norfolk, mm-hmm. never was supposed to be built. Mm-hmm. They're building it right now. And the noise from that place, if this project or if at some point in time something's built between us and that bus terminal, then certainly it's going to help us with a lot of noise that either they're going to have to build a wall or something. For the simple fact is all of the buses now, you know, I can be up praying on Sunday morning and I'm here, the buses go by and the buses stop, you know. And certainly if something's put into that place behind us, then it would keep the noise down from coming in. So I don't see any adverse effect as far as I'm concerned.
You know, it's just a. I don't think that the issue may be zoning. When I look at this plan, I'm very impressed with the plan, especially with the executive summary as to how holistic it is, addressing the historic issues of the area and remediation of those issues and bringing the area in circulation and the economy of the area into line with what is being thought about with for the rest of the area, and especially for downtown. But also maintaining the ability of the stakeholders to remain, if they so choose, in the area and to take part of it. That's what I found that was really exemplary about this plan. And so I understand your point, and I think they're very well taken. The issue then really is it not what is envisioned for that spot? What is there? And so I think it just speaks to understanding what is going to happen. That a multifamily use is with the plan, but what is happening there at that place in line with that plan.
And we do plan on staying there. We've been there since 1864, so we plan on staying there.
Sure, we plan on having you, too. Thank you so much, Reverend Burton. Next, speak in favor of this application, Mr. Thomas Johnson.
Good afternoon. Thanks for having me here. I'm Tom Johnson. I'm Senior Vice President with SL Nussbaum, and my address is 440 Monticello Avenue. And we do have a plan for developing this property, and so the plan has been endorsed by Reverend Burton's church unanimously. We brought it to the Architectural Review Board for an informational session because we are crafting the plans as we speak. And we got some really good constructive feedback there, and we are, as we speak, incorporating that feedback into those plans. So we're going to go through the architectural review process, and the city is going to have every opportunity to make sure it thinks that the plan that we want to accomplish is a good thing. And I'm really going to open myself up to questions for you because I can tell you a little bit about the plan that you're asking about, but certainly it's not finalized because we really need to go back to the drawing board to reflect the constructive criticism that the Architectural Review Board gave us. Mm. So.
You got a little more time left, Mr. Johnson. You want to go ahead and tell us while you're there what you foresee doing with the plans?
Yes. We foresee building a workforce housing apartment community of 120 units. This would be developed to serve an income band of people who don't have a place, they don't have an option to live in downtown Norfolk. We developed the Wells Fargo Center, which is really a block from this site. And our rents at the Wells Fargo Center start at $1,500 a month for a one bedroom and go to $2,200 a month for a three bedroom. That is the rent band that almost all the projects you've approved in downtown are going for, those kind of rents. And I think that's great. I think that's wonderful. But between Tidewater Gardens on the one hand, a public housing project, and Monticello Station Apartments on the other, there isn't a choice for people who make $30,000 to $50,000 to live in downtown Norfolk today. And so that's what our plan seeks to achieve. And it's hard to do that because we can't build a $50 million building like we did at the Wells Fargo Center and have that work out with rents that are in the range of $650 for a one bedroom and $950 for a three bedroom. So that would be our rent band there, and that's serving families who make between $30,000 and $50,000 a year. These are not poor people. These are working people who are trying to improve their lives. Right now, they're living in substandard housing. There is an unlimited demand for this type of housing in the city of Norfolk, and particularly in downtown. When we have developed these in Norfolk before, they have leased up in 6 months, and we have had a waiting list for 120 apartments. We have a waiting list of 1,000 people. That's how underserved the demand is. So we're very excited that we can bring that to downtown.
Thank you. Any questions of Mr. Johnson, commissioners?
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
I have a question.
Sure.
You hear a lot of discussion about the plan.
Yes.
What's your time frame when you think you'll be able to bring something for us to take a look at?
Well, we are. I think we're going to the ARB on January 5th or 8th. Mm-hmm. And then there's another 10 days thereafter. And I think we could bring back that back and show you at your January 22nd meeting.
Okay.
Once we've been through the ARB process.
Mm-hmm. And I just want to say thanks to SL Nussbaum for having an interest, because what I'm hearing is that people haven't been paying attention to St. Paul's Quadrant, and we need to. It's an important part of downtown, and so I appreciate that you're taking that on. I think the challenge that we have up here is trying to figure out exactly what it is that you're planning
yes.
to do. So
absolutely.
I think we all want the same thing. It's just how we get there.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Any other question or comment, commissioners?
I do have one question.
Go right ahead, Mr. Houchins.
Up until this point, I think there's been quite a lot of excitement about development in downtown Norfolk, specifically, projecting what would come through the St. Paul's Quadrant. I'm kind of interested to hear, have you been privy to any discussions on dealing with flooding?
Mm-hmm. We learned a lot about flooding when we developed the Wells Fargo Center, because the Wells Fargo Center sits on land that is at the one end eight and a half feet above sea level, and at the other end is 10.5 feet above sea level, and so we expected that we would have to pay flood insurance and have all these things, but we don't, because our block is not in a flood zone, because Norfolk has a seawall, and our storm drains are separated from the Elizabeth River during a storm, and it's pumped over the seawall. It's a very complex thing. There's a little bit of a New Orleans effect going on in downtown Norfolk. So the Army Corps did a great job back in the 60s when they constructed that. The great thing about this site is, and we'll be able to give you all this when we come back, is that this is high land. So this is not low land. This is actually at about 12 feet above sea level, and it's not in a flood zone. So it's just fortunate that the land is at that level. You know, the church has been there the congregation since 1864 and the church since 1880-something, and they picked a good piece of land to build a church on because it's the high land. You know, actually, Church Street was really, if you look at a map of Norfolk, Norfolk grew along the waterfront, and the first street that it grew north on was Church Street because that was the high land.
As you're looking at issues with regard to flooding,
yes,
because you're at a high point, that goes to a lower point,
mm-hmm.
and I'm concerned that lower point would be Tidewater Gardens that already floods. So just something to consider in terms of surfaces and to the extent that you can create permeable surfaces.
Yes, absolutely.
We would really like to see that.
This will be the first thing that we site plan under the new stormwater regulations because they just went into effect this year. So I am sure we will be overwhelmed with what we have to do here.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. I'm sorry.
One more question. How permeable is the development that you are proposing? Is it gated? Is it open? Is it walkable? What is it?
Well, it's certainly walkable because it's downtown, but we certainly, the church and the prospective residents of this unit, it is on the frontier of downtown. Currently, this is not the safest neighborhood, and by developing this, we hope to make it safer. When you have to have people in a place to be safe. When you have vacant lots, vacant land, that's when things aren't safe because there aren't eyes on the street. So this is going to add to the safety, create environment where today, quite frankly, you or I wouldn't walk over to the church at night. When this is built, you would, because there'll be eyes on the street. So safety is a critical concern, and we will have security gates on the property that you'll have to enter and exit the property by vehicle. You'd have to have a key fob to get in and get out. And there will be, we'll have pedestrian connectivity. The part of Posey Lane that is being closed, if you look at it closely, Posey Lane goes north of the site to Brambleton Avenue and north of Brambleton Avenue, but it's offset here. So when we close Posey Lane, We're going to reopen it at this to line up with the existing Posey Lane. We're going to open that as a pedestrian, as a public access area for pedestrians and bicyclists, so that you can cross this block.
I have a very brief thought about this, and sure. You know, when we talk about the poor, one of the things that
I do want to make it point out, the residents who will be living here are not poor.
My point is that we so desperately need also housing for the poor,
right,
that has all of our ingenuity engaged with it, and our desire to improve the quality of life. And my hope is that in doing, and you've expressed yourself extremely well, and I think everybody very much agrees with that sentiment. But my hope would be that the aspirations of the project are not oppositional to the people who are already there, so that there is a feeling that a community
Not at all. I mean, like Reverend Burton said, four of his congregation members live in Tidewater Gardens. There are certainly people who right now live in Tidewater Gardens who have a good job and have an income in which they can qualify to live here. And when they move out of Tidewater Gardens and into these apartments, that's going to be the best day of their life. Mm. I'm telling you. It is to go from public housing to brand new constructed apartments of the quality that we build is a fantastic thing in a person's life. And so we're in this to make a profit. We're a business. But we feel very proud that we're in this business. And it is doing what we do allows people to improve their lives, unquestionably.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you.
I do want to acknowledge individuals who have signed up in favor of this application but did not wish to speak: George Faulkner Jr., William Mulligan Jr., Helen Myers are here as well. Here to speak against this application, James Watson.
Good afternoon, commissioners. Thank you for hearing my comments. I served on the my name is James Watson, 703 East Virginia Beach Boulevard. I served dutifully on the St. Paul's Quadrant Advisory Committee. Over about 18 months, we took the time to review what every 2 week direct deposit employees who in the course of their work, they in quiet times come up with the best solutions for areas, the best solutions for a problem, the best solutions for things that we, when we're, as you are, ready to make considerations on them. This project, which we don't know, as he said, is not finalized, does not give us the information that I believe at this point tells us that we should move forward with street closures and zoning changes, creation of super blocks that may indeed fit for a certain thing, but may indeed may not fit for developer interests. The project hasn't been considered by you. The project hasn't even been presented to you. The project hasn't even been presented in a fashion that when we are here to view what is actually motivating these changes, it hasn't even been presented in a fashion that we can consider that. From that perspective, it may be good, it may be bad, but what we do know is that it does not follow what Mr. Johnson has spoken on, does not follow the plan of the St. Paul's Advisory Committee.
Thank you, Mr. Watson. Any questions to Mr. Watson, commissioners? Mr. Watson, you gave an address of Brambleton Avenue?
703 East Virginia Beach Boulevard.
Okay, are you in any way aligned with the quadrant? I know you served on the committee.
I served on the committee. I'm a stakeholder, property owner of the area.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions of Mr. Watson? Thank you. Also here to speak against this application, Kevin Murphy.
Hi, Kevin Murphy, 109 College Place, downtown Norfolk, also president of the Downtown Norfolk Civic League. I'm here to speak against the application just because the Civic League hasn't had time to review the proposed ordinance changes. We were notified on December 3rd, which would be a week ago, that the change from C2 to D2 was going to be on the agenda, and also learned of the street closures. A couple days later, I had a meeting at SL Nesbaum to see the proposal that is so development proposal, which is so closely linked to the zoning changes. And I know that our members would be very interested in also seeing it and having their comments heard because the zoning changes are so closely related to the development. The development is driving these zoning changes. And our residents approved in the past. We're very interested in this area. We fought very hard, actually, to get the bus transfer station located elsewhere because we thought there was greater potential for the St. Paul's Quadrant. Even though that didn't happen, we still stayed engaged in the process, attended the three working charrettes that the architects and the city hosted, and worked to come up with the best bus transfer station that would be possible for this area. It feels like on this, we've been, if not shut out, just notified so late that we can't schedule SL Nesbaum or the city planning department to come to our Civic League meeting to talk through the proposed zoning changes and development proposal that's linked with it. We'd like that opportunity before we form a specific position on the issue. There are reasons for concern. The biggest one, you know, as far as the zoning changes is concerned, is the super block that's going to be created in a downtown. That might happen for a mall, but generally urban development looks for short walkable blocks that are in mixed use. And the development proposal, as I've seen, has a lot of things that are contrary to what is considered good urban planning. So I appreciate the opportunity to speak.
Thank you, Kevin. Appreciate you coming down. Also want to acknowledge an individual who wishes to ask questions on this project, Reverend Morey. Robert A. Morey, you have any questions now, Dr. Morey? We'll seek to try to answer them for you if we can.
Mr. Fraley and members of the commission, good afternoon. My name is Robert G. Murray. I am the senior pastor of the historic First Baptist Church at 418 East Butte Street here in downtown Norfolk. I'm also a resident of the city. I live at 862 Wedgefield Court, area code 2350. I've been around here for a few years, pastored First Baptist for the last 31 years. I've seen this city go through metamorphosis, and it's a wonderful thing to see the development of the city. I believe that even the plan for the St. Paul's Quadrant is a great one, it's a good one, and certainly would affirm any efforts to help a sister church such as St. John's. They're doing a marvelous and wonderful work in the community. My only concern is, what is the process? How does things move from one state to another? I have also served on the advisory committee of the St. Paul's Quadrant. And the last I heard was that it was going to be moving to city council. I don't know whether that has been done. It could be my not knowing. But I would like to know, how does a person become involved in the development of the area? Do you have an RFP, I think it's called? I mean, what is the process? It's plain and simple.
Mm-hmm. George, you want to respond to that?
Well, Dr. Murray, I will start in terms of the status of the St. Paul's plan. The plan did go to council, and city council, while agreeing with the vision, chose not to adopt the plan as an area plan amendment to the plan Norfolk 2030. As I think has been mentioned previously, a lot of the vision from the St. Paul's Quadrant plan is contained in Plan Norfolk 2030. So the work was not wasted. It's in the general plan, but not to the degree and specificity as the area plan itself was. As far as the process by which folks can indicate an interest to purchase and develop property acquired to be acquired from the city. Unfortunately, I don't have that answer very well. I believe, and I could be wrong, but I believe that the process is that an applicant prepares a letter of intent to the city explaining what they believe they can do and establishing certain parameters for which they would, by, under which they would acquire the property from the city. Those go to the city's development department and at some point find their way to city council, but I'm not involved in that process and I really don't know how that works.
Okay, so this sounds like you have to apply as such to the city manager's office or city council, and that's the process?
Yes, sir. I believe something akin to that, yes, sir.
Okay. So has that been done?
I'm not part of that letter of intent process, but my understanding is that the city did receive a letter of intent from S.L. Nussbaum and perhaps from at least one other potential purchaser of the particular parcel here, and ultimately city council has chosen the Nussbaum proposal as the what to go forward with.
Well, is there ever a public hearing where the public can have at least some input in the process?
That's always available at city council. And here we have a part of the process of looking at a particular parcel associated with the quadrant. Mm-hmm. Assuming we proceed with a zoning change on this particular application, we will have delineated a parcel of the St. Paul quadrant for a subsequent development.
Okay.
But if you want to speak to the process of acquiring or in some way, shape, or form developing a piece of land in that quadrant or any other part of the city, you would likely start, as George said, in economic development with a letter of intent or to the city manager's office or something of like nature.
And well, I guess my concern.
And go right ahead.
I was going to add, Mr. Chairman, there are any number of ways that a proposal might come in the door. If the city knows about something it wants, there may be a request for proposals, an RFP. It may be that somebody in the market identifies a need. And so there may be an unsolicited proposal that comes in. So it's really hard to describe any specific process. But what I can say is that before any zoning is changed, there's a public hearing. Before any property of the city is disposed of, there's a public hearing with notice, et cetera. So while there may be a lot of different ways it can come in the door, it doesn't get approved until there's a public hearing and notice before city council. So that end of the process is formal. The incidences of how it kind of gets started isn't as formal.
Three quick questions. Has that process been done where you have the public hearing yet?
No. Okay. There is no.
And I presume you're talking about the public hearing on the St. Paul quadrant itself.
Yes, as well as this area of 5 acres. Mm.
We're having that hearing now in terms of rezoning the 5 acres.
The zoning, but some of this land is owned by the city.
Yeah.
And the public hearing, if that land is going to be sold, has not been held. So
okay.
You'd be looking for that as part of this. If this specific development plan that Mr. Johnson's talking about is to proceed, then that part of it, the disposition and how that's going to work, price and all of that, would be part of a public hearing.
My naive question, has it then been sold to S.L. Nussbaum?
No. That'll all be discussed at a public hearing if there is a negotiation.
Let me just raise two more questions, and here's my place of concern. As being a part of that advisory committee, one of the things that was on record to do was to see that 618 people, units, would be somehow a part of the St. Paul's Quadrant. And I guess I would be very concerned that historically, in this city, it has not been often where persons who have dwelled in a particular area have ever become a part of the new area. The second one is a concern for historic buildings. Mm-hmm. We start building somewhere, I would really want to be concerned that we ensure that those buildings, such as my 108-year-old building, with stained glass windows and really a beautiful architecture is going to be preserved. That's my question.
Thank you, Reverend Murray.
You're welcome, sir. Yeah, thank you very much.
That concludes those in favor. We do have the opportunity for a rebuttal. We have a total of 5 minutes. Is anyone who wants to speak either in tandem or one individual want to speak in favor of this application at this time? That opportunity presents itself right now. Hearing none, anyone on the opposition side has 5 minutes to speak against this project, either in tandem or individually. If anyone would like to speak, you have that opportunity now. Hearing and seeing none, any commissioners have any comment? Question?
The only comment I would like to make, basically just for clarity for Dr. Murray, is that this hearing is strictly concerning the rezoning of the property and the street and two street closures. It has nothing to do with transfer of land or anything of that nature. So I just wanted to make sure that that was.
Thank you, Mr. House. Is there any other comment?
I would just quickly comment that this is a bit outside of our normal procedure to not have the applicant meet with the Civic League. And certainly the applicant here is the city, but we certainly have interest from the Civic League here in this application. I think we'd like to hear from the DNC on this particular application. I think they should be afforded the opportunity to see what SL Nussbaum is proposing. And I certainly believe that we should be afforded the opportunity to see what's being proposed, just like we do on every other rezoning that I can recall that's, as was said earlier, is tied to a site plan. So my motion would be to continue it till at least the January time frame to allow them the time to do that.
I would want to echo that. I think our history, at least since I've been on this commission, certainly since I've been chairman, project of this size and this magnitude and this zoning impact, we generally see something, physical renderings of what we can project to be on a particular site, and allowing for a zoning change of this magnitude. I think I would have to echo the sentiments of the vice chair there. We want to be extremely careful, and from my perspective, having spent an inordinate amount of my personal time with regard to coming up with the vision embodied in the St. Paul Quadrant study, which, as George pointed out, hasn't been adopted by City Council as a area plan, but certainly is incorporated in what Council has approved as a comprehensive plan, which called for a mixed residential at subsidized housing, workforce housing, market rate housing, all within one development, so that we can see much of what we've seen. To echo what Melvin Morey said, in the Broad Creek area, where people who live in what was formerly Bowling Park did get the opportunity to come back and live in that same community. And we want to try to see this as a first major foray into this major area of our downtown. Is indeed in keeping with the spirit and intent of what that is. Certainly, I can appreciate that St. John's is about the business of wanting to protect their congregation and get parking. And I think our history in dealing with churches as a commission has been exemplary. We have always bent over backwards to try to accommodate churches for their long-term needs as best as possible. But I think it's important for us to recognize that we have a major study which says we want to develop this the same way. I'd like to see what the Nussbaum project looks like before I think I'm prepared to vote in favor of a rezoning that would open the window for virtually any type of development to come in that particular site. Yes, sir, George.
Mr. Chairman, I'd be remiss if I didn't point out, as Mr. Thomas did, that this is, in fact, an application from the City of Norfolk. And there are some timelines that are associated with it that are relatively short, and therefore the city's request is to move this forward up or down, one way or the other, today. Mr. Johnson, in his comments, pledged that this project will go through the design review process, and thus this body will have an opportunity to see what the proposed project is going to be. And let me add, I know there was some discussion about stormwater, and Mr. Johnson certainly alluded to, we have a new stormwater regulations that that we, our department enforces together with Public Works. This site, and in fact any site, will be required to go through an extensive review of the stormwater. There are, as I think I mentioned before, lots of different ways of addressing stormwater issues. We are encouraging folks to be as creative as possible, to treat as many of the raindrops as close to where they fall as possible. And this certainly will be an opportunity for us to begin the process in the St. Paul's quadrant.
George, we respect and appreciate that. Let me speak for myself. I respect and appreciate that. But I think we've established a track record here on this commission that we don't move forward with circumstances of this magnitude without having seen some reasonable renderings of what might end up on that site. And if that ruffles some feathers, we're big boys and girls. We'll deal with that.
I would have to add my voice to that because I think it's been shown here today that the Downtown Neighborhood League and other groups have been very invested in this area and what it could mean for the city and its impact. This is outside of what we normally do. I think it's very important that we show that it's an even-handed project that is in line with what we have historically done. And I feel, in light of that, that we really need to see what the proposals are on the table for the development of the area and not move until it's understood what we're getting.
We have any other comment with regard to that? We entertain a motion.
As I understand, the motion that I'm going to read will be to continue the item. The motion is to continue the item to the public hearing to be held on Thursday, January 22nd, 2015, 2:30 p.m., the City Council Chambers, 11th floor, City Hall Building, Civic Center, Norfolk, Virginia. Dr. Newman?
Aye.
Ms. McQuillan?
Yes.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Mr. Fraley?
Aye. We look forward to seeing that in the very near future. Thank you. Next item on the agenda, item 4, Linwood.
Yes, this request is by Kevin Hubbard for a change of zoning from R7 single family to conditional R8 one family, single family, on property fronting 106 feet more or less along the northern line of Widgeon Road and beginning 100 feet more or less from the western line of Partridge Street and running westwardly. Premises numbered 980 Widgeon Road.
Thank you, Lenny. We have some folks who have been a little bit incomplete in filling out these applications, agenda items. Cora Freeman, do you wish to speak, Ms. Freeman?
Did he channel his inner?
Not here, okay. Jacqueline Roberts is here in you for this application. You do not wish to speak? All right, ma'am. Charles Schmidt does not wish to speak, but is in favor of this application. Thank you, sir. And wouldn't you know it, he's only going to speak if he needs to. Garnsey West, who's the president of the Inglenook Carnival Civic League. So we hear no opposition. I do want to acknowledge for the record that Mr. West did issue a letter in support of this application. Lenny?
The motion to recommend that the change of zoning be approved subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Dr. Newman?
Aye.
Ms. McQuillan?
Yes.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
All right.
That recommendation to the council. Thank you.
The next application to come before you is number 5, Muddy Paws, for a special exception. Operate a kennel with an outdoor area, property fronting 75 feet more or less along the eastern line of Hampton Boulevard, beginning 125 feet more or less from the southern line of 38th Street, extending southwardly. Property also fronts 150 feet more or less along the northern line of 37th Street. Premises numbered 3700 Hampton Boulevard.
Thank you, Lenny. Here to speak in favor of this application is the applicant, Mary Ann Jacobson.
Oh, yeah.
Hi, good afternoon, Commissioners. Actually, my name is Angela Owens. Marianne asked that I speak for her. I'm the other owner of Muddy Paws at 3700 Hampton Boulevard. I just wanted to take a few minutes to answer some questions for you. Oh, go ahead.
No, I just want you to give us your name and mailing address.
Oh, Angela Owens, 3700 Hampton Boulevard, okay. Norfolk, Virginia.
All right.
I wanted to just explain what Muddy Paws was. We are a care facility. And our approach is kind of a holistic approach. We work with to teach customers about food, better food for their animals. We work with grooming, better care for their animals. We provide daycare, for a place for their animals to go during the day while they're at work. And then also what we're requesting for is the variance for our kennel, to be able to use a kennel. The kennel actual boarding area is indoors. They stay indoors overnight. We have somebody stay with them overnight. The outdoor area is only utilized from, they go out about 8 o'clock in the morning after breakfast, and they play most of the day. They get a nap time around noon, and then they go in around 6 o'clock for dinner, and then they come out one more time at around 8 o'clock to go out to the bathroom before they go in for sleeping. So we are surrounded by an industrial area, and we are requesting a variance to our zoning to be able to keep our kennel space there.
Just a curiosity, how many animals can you house at one time?
We had almost close to 90.
Really?
Yeah. We have over 6,000 customers in our database that we serve for the city of Norfolk. We've actually been around since we had a smaller retail store and a grooming store in Collie. Mm-hmm. And we moved to Hampton Boulevard about 4 years ago. So we've been in business for about 10 years. Mm-hmm. But we have about over 6,000 customers in our database. So that's just our regular customers that come through for food, grooming, daycare, boarding. Mm-hmm. That doesn't include our walk-in customers.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any questions, Commissioners?
Just a quick clarification for maybe the people watching at home. This is not a variance. It's going to be a special exception.
Okay.
Variances are handled by a different board.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Other than that, I note that we have no opposition to this application.
The motion before you is to recommend that the special exception be approved, subject to conditions contained in the staff report. Dr. Newman?
I'm pleased to see there's ample outdoor area for the dogs as well. I vote aye.
Ms. McQuillan?
Yes.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Mr. Fraley?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation to council. Good luck.
Next application is a request number 6 by 7-Eleven Incorporated for the following applications on property located in the Church Street Crossing Shopping Center, fronting 117 feet, more or less, along the northern line of East Brambleton Avenue, and 197 feet, more or less, along the eastern line of Church Street, premises numbered 800 East Brambleton Avenue. The special exception is, one is to operate a convenience store 24 hours with fuel sales, and B, a special exception for the sale of alcoholic beverages for off-premises consumption.
Hello, Commissioners. So, as Lenny stated, this next application is to construct a 7-Eleven located at 800 East Brambleton Avenue. The property is zoned C3 and is located at the corner of Church Street and Brambleton Ave in the Church Street Shopping Center. With this application, it is important to note, as Lenny did, that there are two special exceptions. I'll state them again. One, to operate a 24-hour convenience store with gas sales, and two, to permit the sale of alcohol for off-premise consumption. Considering the project will have to go through site plan review, it is a tear down, build a new building. Considering it will have to go through site plan review and meet all city regulations, staff is in support of this application. Here are the proposed elevations that were attached with the application. With that, any questions you might have, I'd be glad to answer.
Have you heard from any of the surrounding businesses and or civic leagues?
We have not. Standard practice, as we always do, we did notify the civic league, but we have not heard one way or the other.
Thank you, Ashton. Any comment of Ashton? Thank you, Ash. Here to speak in favor of this application, Mr. Stephen Romine.
Good afternoon, Chairman Fraley and members of the Planning Commission. For the record, my name is Steve Romine, 999 Waterside Drive, Norfolk, 23510. I have with me today as well Roger Pope, who is the Land Design Development, who is the engineer, who has done the site plan. The architect's not here, but we can try to address questions if you have them. We are requesting the special exceptions for 24 hours with fuel sales and the alcohol beverage sales off-premises. I'll be brief because I think you have a full package on there, but let me just go over the site very quickly. It's a 0.75-acre parcel currently developed with a BP gas station, which is a kiosk and a car wash in the back. The kiosk will be removed. The car wash will be removed. It's a demolish and rebuild, so we're going to build it from the ground up. It's currently zoned Z3 retail center, which permits this 24-hour convenience store with fuel and the sale of off-premises alcohol. That is permitted within the zoning. This is the corner of Church Street and Brambleton Avenue, as indicated by Mr. Jones. We intercept traffic, and no traffic impacts or significant impacts were noted or concerned. Briefly, when you look at the site plan, and it's in your package, the East Brambleton's here, Church Street is here. We are on the corner of an existing shopping center. There is a grocery store that's closed here and some other strip users here. This shopping center has excess parking spots. We are going to enter into a parking agreement and pick up 12 additional spots to meet, to overpark what we need on the redevelopment for this site. But let me explain real quickly. The existing access on Brambleton will be moved further away from the intersection, which is favorable from traffic and public works. The access point currently on Church Street will be closed, and we will use a joint access into the shopping center. So that's a very positive development as well. This entrance or access point into the shopping center for circulation will remain open. We will close a couple others that are currently there that give you free flow and limit it to one entrance exit point into the shopping center here where we have our additional parking. The canopy with the four MPDs, multi-product dispensers, will be oriented toward East Brambleton Street. The store will be in the back of the site. 3,000 square foot store is about a standard size store for us. You'll notice nice landscaping around the back of the store and in the front and on the side, which does not currently exist. So I think it's going to be a dramatic facelift for a corner that needs some redevelopment. And the owner, Mr. Weaver, has struck a deal with the landlord over here to do this. He wants to make this investment and upgrade his property on that corner, make it a more full service operation than it is today. As I said, right now it operates as a kiosk. So I think that's very positive. On the design side, you saw some of those pictures. I'll show you the front side view. These really are kind of flat, don't give it all the elements that you would see in a more complete design. But essentially you have this hip roof A-frame feature here. It'll be full brick on the side, just to clarify that, not a thin brick. We're meeting the glazing requirements with all the glass in the front. Also helps with security. As I indicate, on the security side, Mr. Weaver is committed to allowing the police to have a substation in the site because there's one concern that has been expressed is security in the area and the loitering. And so there'll be a lot of light, a lot of security, and full glass and extra cameras. So heavily cameraed. He's also told me today that to the extent that he feels like he needs to, he'll have a security guard from 6 to 6 on the site, just to make sure his employees are safe as well. So he's very concerned about addressing the neighborhood concerns and preventing potential loitering in that area. To be fair, the Civic League letters went out. We had no comments. We have been called by them recently, and they were not meeting in December. So we've committed to go ahead and meet with them when we can and address any issues they have. But the only one expressed to me by them was the potential for loitering and drawing people to the site. And so I just wanted to put that on the record as well. So we think high design, really an improvement, again, increased security. 7-Eleven's a good corporate citizen and significantly contributes to the employment in Norfolk tax base. He will have as many as 15 employees at this location. So that's good for employment. Increase retail sales will increase the tax revenue as well. We believe also it will upgrade the corner, will help as a catalyst in that area, particularly another grocer, I think, is coming in the strip behind it. There's already some convenience in the area, so the products are sold in that area, but this will be a really nice upgrade on that corner. I think those are the highlights. I just wanted to let you know about the police substation. I think that's something that's important as well. The conditions are acceptable. We signed them ahead of time and have given them to staff. Again, it's the automobile gas and supply station, four double-sided fuel pumps, and we've worked closely with staff, and we'll continue to work with the Civic League. And for all those reasons, we ask that you recommend approval to the City Council.
Steve, a couple of questions. Yes, this will be a 24-hour location?
It's intended to be 24 hours, correct.
And you say improved lighting. Are we looking at lighting on all four sides of this structure?
Mr. Pope is here. Do you know what the lighting plan is yet, Roger?
Well, we can go ahead and put wall packs on all four sides.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, Mr. Weaver told me he intends to just really increase the lighting, obviously keep it so it doesn't fade off into off-property, but that the site itself be very well secured.
My concern is that that location is a potential for loitering.
Yes.
Based on where you are there in our city. And light seems to
help
in cutting that down. You mentioned a police substation. Mm-hmm. This would be located within the structure?
Yeah, what typically 7-Eleven has done in areas where there's been a concern expressed is they'll set up a desk or a little portion of the store where the police officers can come in and fill out their reports and have some visibility. Usually they put a shield on the window, shows that it is a police substation. People come in and make complaints there as well. I don't think it'll be manned 24/7, but it will be manned periodically and will be officially stated as such. And that has to be accepted by the police department, and they have to say they want that. Right now, we don't know if there's going to be an agreement, but in other areas where we've reached out, not only in Norfolk, but in Virginia Beach and other places where the police department has said, yes, it's something we'd like, we have actually done that. Mm-hmm. And it takes a different style depending on the store layout and what we do, but normally it's a location for the police to come. Now, you may know that we have an open policy already, 7-Eleven does, where police are welcome, and we do provide coffee and donuts. And so we do encourage them to come in because we want their presence in our locations. So that policy wouldn't change here, but this would be one step further where we give them some space to do some reports.
I'm just trying to envision. Are you saying that in order for a police officer to access this space, he will go through the store, or he will have access from this space from the exterior of the store?
Normally, it's in the store. It's not a separate entrance. I've seen them where they've had separate entrances.
He will have a separate entrance. Well,
you want to come up, Roger?
Introduce
yourself. Tell them your address.
Okay. My name's Roger Pope, Land Design Development, 6371 Center Drive, Norfolk, 23502.
Mm-hmm.
We submitted a floor plan that came in with the ABC application, and you'll see there's a vacant office in there. It will have its separate entrance on the side, and there will be the shield, but they will be able to lock and secure their own offices from the outside.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my concern there, of course, if there was any type of police activity going on, I'm sure you wouldn't want to take that through your...
No, they'll have their own access.
Yeah, okay.
And there'll probably be a mirror, one-way mirror. They can watch activities in the store.
Mm-hmm.
But they will have their own access.
I didn't have the ABC application. I apologize. So.
Not a problem.
Yeah.
Mr. Carmine, I see from what you've presented on your board that you have a somewhat different design proportions to the building as opposed to what we are seeing on the screen over there. You've put some brick pilasters there to break up the window front.
Mm-hmm.
It's articulated differently than what is there. And that's not a bad thing. It's a head ball.
These are? Okay. Well, he's telling me.
Hold that up.
Have you submitted these to us at all?
Ashton.
Steve, we need a copy.
What?
I don't believe so. This is what we have.
Okay. They have that, Roger. They don't have this. Again, this is what we'd like to do.
Well, let me ask you a question, if I may. you're comfortable with your site plan, you're comfortable with your elevations, and you want to accomplish those, I'm going to put those in the conditions. Is that acceptable?
That's fine, yeah.
Thank you.
In fact, the reference in the plan here said Exhibit A, but it was really called Exhibit C, so there was a typo in there.
We just need to modify
but
that.
But you don't have the most recent plans, so that's a good point. I wasn't aware of that myself because I didn't know what the city had here. So, but the idea is to meet the glazing requirements on the front. I think this may be a little more attractive with it.
Indeed.
You break the glass up, so.
Steve, can we eyeball the rest of the elevations since they might be different from what we've seen?
And my understanding from Roger is that we took the template off the Ballantyne property. The drawings, you know, again, are kind of one-dimensional. That's the rear side. Mm-hmm. And Roger, these are faux windows or real windows? These are faux windows.
Is there glass in there, or that just?
Well, it's faux. There's glass, like, but there's, you know, there's nothing. You can't see through them.
Not structural.
Yeah, not structural. Yeah. And then this is the left side and the right side. And again, here's more of a angular version showing the side window.
And is the signage depicted in those, is that the totality of the signage that you expect to have on the building?
That's the totality of signage on the building on the front, I believe, Roger. On the front here with the kiosk, I mean with the top table.
Can we
would have a separate sign package showing signage on the site, you know, the monument sign and on the canopy as well. So, and I don't have a rendering of the canopy here. So.
Can we add it as a condition that will be the totality of the signage in the building? Is that okay with the applicant?
I mean, it's a totality of the signs, I believe, on the building.
Yeah.
You're saying?
I know you'll have more on the site, certainly.
Right. And I don't know if we're allowed anything on the side. And I don't see anything depicted on the side. Roger, that's all we have on the side. Okay, no other signs.
Okay.
To his knowledge.
Two things. Information. You've built a number of these.
Mm-hmm.
Is it basically the same structure every time, or do you vary them in terms of how they look, the design of the buildings? Out of curiosity, do you do that, or is this your basic model that you use for most of your construction?
Well, what happens in the market typically is 7-Eleven has to approve all their designs. They have some prototypical designs when they build a store, mm-hmm. you know, that they've built other places. This particular store is owned by Mr. Weaver, and he's building 2-7-Eleven spec, but he has an ability to upgrade and change around. He owns Ballantyne as well. So what he did was he took the Ballantyne site and he's reproducing it here to some degree. Not exactly brick for brick, mm-hmm. but same basic floor plan. So to answer your question, not to be evasive, 7-Eleven has standard custom plans. This is not one of them. This is a custom plan from an owner who is converting the BP to a 7-Eleven. So he has a little more flexibility to do different design. And so this design wouldn't be one that 7-Eleven would have in their book back in Dallas, but it'd be one that they would approve. Okay. It's built in the marketplace. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I had one other question. Is the canopy just going to be rebadged, or is it going to be replaced?
Oh, it's going to be knocked. There's no canopy there now, I don't think. Well, on both sides of the kiosk. So it's got to be reconfigured, right?
Yeah, there is an existing canopy.
But it's not the... Yeah, because right now the configuration is kiosk in the middle of canopies both sides. Now we're going to have a kiosk in the front.
Okay.
So it's going to be raised.
Yeah. I need to ask a question of Mr. Romine.
Adam.
So this is not owned by 7-Eleven, Inc.?
Well, it's owned by Tidewater Investments, LLC, who's the applicant.
Okay. So the special exception needs to go to the...
Tidewater Investments, LLC. Mm-hmm. He'll operate as a 7-Eleven.
That's fine.
Yeah.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure I had the correct legal name.
Yeah, we worried about
today,
transferring and assigning and all the stuff like that, yeah.
Right.
But
Tidewater Investments.
LLC, that's the applicant, right, Ash?
LLC.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And then,
go ahead.
Lenny, are we comfortable, are we going to get a copy of those so that we can attach those?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Before it leaves our office, we'll get it.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm sure.
Yep. Good. We'll get it for you.
Steve, it's your last opportunity. Anything else you want to give us before you leave?
No, just it's full brick. We think it's a nice improvement for the corner. We look forward. I mean, Chuck's already operating there. He just really wants to upgrade the corner. Mm-hmm. I think it's be a positive for the area. So,
I don't mean to delay this. Did you speak at all to any landscaping?
Yes. Yes, I showed
you. I missed that. I'm sorry.
Site plan. substantial. Right now, there is really none. I was out there the other day. We've got landscaping in this front area where we're getting rid of this. Okay. We're moving this entrance back, so that landscape will come all the way up into that entrance. So nicely landscape it, escape on the corner, wrapping all the way along the side of Church Street, getting rid of the entrance on Church so we can landscape right through there, okay, all the way to the rear of the site, and so behind the site. And then this is the shared access, and then there's landscaping island here and through here on the side into the parking lot. Okay. So it's going to create a look of its own parcel versus right now it doesn't have that. It has a chain link fence. Mm-hmm. So I think will be nicely improved.
Thank you, Steve. Any other questions, comments, commissioners?
Steve's getting too good at this.
Getting good, isn't he?
Sorry about that. Sorry for the misinformation, but I think we got it all together, so all right. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Yeah. Lenny?
The motion is to recommend that the special exception be approved subject to the conditions contained in the staff report and further subject to the site plan and the proposed elevations showing all of the signage on the building itself, and in addition, the use of full brick on the building. Somewhere there's a, here it is. Dr. Newman?
Aye.
Ms. McQuillan?
Yes.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Halgins?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Mr. Fraley?
Aye. Make that recommendation to council. Good luck with that.
Thank you.
The next application is Tire City for a special exception to operate an automobile and truck repair facility on property running 140 feet more or less along the western line of North Military Highway and 126 feet more or less along the southern line of Norview Avenue, premises numbered 3655 North Military Highway.
All right, this request is by Tire City. It's for a special exception for automobile and truck repair. The site is located on the southwest corner of North Military Highway and Norview Avenue. And it is zoned C2, which does allow the use with a special exception. The site actually already has the use present, and it has had automobile or truck repair in some form or another for the past 45 years. However, the applicant is looking to expand the current site, expand the current building to facilitate his operations.
Hey, Steve.
And through the expansion, he is having to apply for this special exception to become conforming. I will point out that we do have in the city's plan, Norfolk 2030, references to the adopted military highway corridor plan that was seen by you guys several years back. Maybe just a few of you guys, Earl might remember. But this plan was adopted, and I will point out one graphic in the plan that is specific to this property, which is where it calls out this intersection as a gateway to the airport specifically. So I did want to call that out. Through working with the applicant and this site, we have drafted several conditions that would bring the site into conformity. I will speak on a few of these conditions. I might not read every single one of these, but specifically that a landscape plan shall be reviewed and approved by the Department of City Planning and the Department of Recreation, Parks, and Open Space, showing that landscaping complies with the provisions as specified by Section 17-7, which is our section of the zoning ordinance. If you remember when you went out to the site, the frontage on Norview Avenue has no landscaping at all. The parking comes directly to the sidewalk and without any landscaping. And in talking with the applicant, he understands and agrees that in order for staff to recommend approval, that he will need to install that landscaping. So that is a condition. It's covered and under the first condition that you see here, and the applicant has agreed to that. Also, the non-conforming sign on the site shall be either removed or modified in order to become conforming with the requirements of the zoning ordinance, and the applicant has agreed to that and the conditions that he's signed, and that the addition to the building would be an addition along the front of the building, a 20 by 30 foot addition along the front face facing Norview Avenue, and I think that was a result of some concerns of possibly adding more bays along facing Military Highway, and that that wasn't a preferred option, and the applicant has agreed to that addition. Also, that a detailed work plan sufficient to properly obtain all necessary building permits to accommodate the proposed building expansion, that shall be submitted to the Department of City Planning within 6 months of the adoption date of the ordinance. Specifically to remind you guys that this is an existing operation, and if we are going to recommend approval to this commission, we do want to know in the conditions that there is some expeditious completion of the request. So that's why that condition is in the ordinance. And we do want to be sure that no work shall be done outside, and that no work shall be commenced on the addition until the planning department has approved the addition. And also that all work described in the approved work plan shall be fully completed within 12 months of their submission to the planning department. There are other standard, we call them boilerplate conditions in the ordinance. I won't go through every one, but it's the standard conditions that we attach to any special exception for automobile-related use, and all of those are in your ordinance. With that, given all of the conditions that the applicant has agreed to for all of the recommended improvements to the site, staff does recommend approval of this special exception.
Thank you, Matthew. Right. Any questions, commissioners?
For clarification for the record, the application is being made by the...
By the tenant, Mr. Joe Whitehead, mm-hmm. who operates the Tire City facility in the building. And the property owner has signed on the application as well. So understanding...
Oh, who's going to bear the costs of...
That's really not the planning department's role to make uh-huh. that decision. In one way or the other, they will have to work that out.
And together?
I don't know. Maybe together, or maybe the applicant will just pay for all of it. I don't know. But I'm not sure if the applicant's here to speak, but maybe if he is, he might be able to better address that question.
Thank you, Matthew. Any other questions of Matthew? Obviously, the applicant hadn't signed up. Is the applicant here?
Oh. The owner's here.
Okay. Would you want to add something to respond to the question of the commissioner?
As far as the cost, sir?
Or who's absorbing it?
We haven't discussed that yet.
What I want to clarify.
Letter.
My name.
I'm sorry. My name. You would say your name and
okay.
address.
My name's Helen Merges, owner of the property, representing my mother. Home address or the... 949 Calypso Lane, Virginia Beach, Virginia, 23454. The question?
I want to clarify because we have gone to the site. We have seen the site.
Right.
And it has some constraints because of where it is. It's uh-huh. backed up to a creek.
Right.
There are some sheds on the side because mm-hmm. there's so much inventory.
Mm-hmm.
And the proposal is to push a bay out and push the bays forward so that there's more room. But there's a lot of inventory on this site. And is it possible to develop it to the side where the sheds are so that there is, so that you can put the inventory there as opposed to pushing it out and putting the inventory because there's a question mm-hmm. in mind about will that be effective? And that really was the basis of my question, was how this can get done mm-hmm. and the relationship between the applicant, who is the tenant, and the mm-hmm. owner to make this happen mm-hmm. in the most expeditious way that's mm-hmm. best for both. That was really the basis of my question.
Okay, let me try to answer it the best that I can, according to the way you asked the questions. At this point, I mean, we've been grandfathered and we've been doing this since 1978, and we really never had a reason to expand it, but the level of business that they're doing at this point is what brought all this on. We discussed it with them several different ways to do it off to the side, off to the front, off on the left side, whatever we were gonna do, because the buildings that are off to the side now have been approved by building and have zoning and ordinances and all that. After belaboring it quite a bit with them, we all agreed that in the front was the best way to basically do it. So we have not really, the tenant literally is going to take on the expense, though, I can assure you, because it was not necessary up until this point. And if they're doing that much more business, and they personally need it to do it, you know, rightfully so, they're going to do it. We've done quite a bit as well already with the paving of the, you know, parking lot and everything else. So they're putting everything together and getting their estimates and doing everything, and that's why we met with them so many times that we did, because we're trying to come into conformance in order to do this, including landscaping and some of the other things that you guys have asked.
Thank you. We have any other questions, commissioners?
Have elevations or plans been drawn up for the addition to the building?
No, not at this time. I think they were in, no, I think actually we did draw up a certain. No, not specifically for the front of the building.
My concern is this is, as you heard earlier, it's a gateway intersection to the city. And that particular site as it sits right now, and we did go out there, is not really attractive. I think he had a couple of tractor trailers out there parked with a bunch of tires in them. He's got the two sheds. Mm-hmm. And the building itself is not one of the most attractive buildings either for a gateway intersection. And so I think that's a lot of the basis of Ms. Austin's question is, mm-hmm, how can the addition to this building be done in such a way that it helps the gateway rather than just continues to be a hodgepodge of small buildings on a undersized site.
Right.
And so I'd like to see both the landscape plan and the elevations before we'd move forward. I don't know whether that's something that you can provide to us come January.
I can ask the tenant if he'd like to draw something up, absolutely. But I know to the building itself, I don't know if you had been out there in the last year, there's been over $50,000 put into the building itself to rehab the building on the outside as well.
Okay.
So just to note that as well, which is where we had, how far we had come from there as well.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. What did you do to the outside of that building?
All of the new brick was in done. Okay. All the bathrooms were gutted out. The office in the back was gutted out. There was a lot of stuff that needed to be redone that had not been done for a long time.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other questions, commissioners, comment? No, you weren't planning to be in at that podium. We appreciate you sharing with us the information.
Thank you. Uh-huh.
Thank you so much. Any other comment, commissioners?
No.
Is this a request for a continuance or a request to proceed with it?
Well, I think, Lenny, there's some trepidation amongst this body as to what we might be getting. We just earlier asked to see something on a previous request. I think we probably are looking at the same thing here. We got a tight space. It's a gateway location. I think this commission would probably want to see something that's going to reflect exactly what's going to end up there before we give a special exception to proceed.
Understand the motion, therefore.
Am I speaking out of church, commissioners?
Yeah. Sounds reasonable. I move that we continue and hopefully get some drawings in January. It doesn't sound like we're going to set back the plans significantly by waiting, and we'll have a better feel for the drawings and the landscaping.
All right. The motion is to continue the item to the public hearing to be held on Thursday, January 22nd, 2015 at 2:30 p.m. in the City Council Chambers, 11th floor, City Hall Building, Civic Center, Norfolk, Virginia. Dr. Newman?
Aye.
Ms. McQuillan?
Yes.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
And Mr. Fraley?
Aye. Thank you. We look forward to seeing that.
Next application is number 8 by Vincent Powell for a special exception to operate an automobile and truck repair facility on property fronting 50 feet more or less along the northern line of Avenue J, beginning 600 feet more or less from the western line of Merritt Street and extending westwardly, premises numbered 860 Avenue J.
All right. This project is for a special exception to operate an auto and truck repair facility. Specifically, this will be auto related, I believe, but I guess they will be doing tires, so they might do trucks as well. This is located at 860 Avenue J. The property is zoned C2 and is located just south of Little Creek Road. just east of Sewell's Point, so pretty much just south of the intersection of Little Creek and Sewell's Point. It's surrounded by a bunch of commercial uses. While this site was at one point used for auto repair, that use ceased in 2010, and so it lost its grandfathering per our 2-year grandfathering clause. This would reestablish the use as an auto repair facility. With all special exceptions per Chapter 25, which is the special exception chapter of the zoning ordinance, various conditions relating to use, character, landscaping, screening can be implemented, requested by staff in order to try and improve the site. With this application, at the time of application, there was no suggestion by the applicant that they wanted to improve the site, so no landscaping was presented to us. With that knowledge, staff had a negative opinion. Since the writing of the staff report and this PowerPoint, staff has received conditions from the applicant signed, saying that they are willing to put in all the landscaping requirements that City Planning Department and RPOS, the Department of Parks, Recreation, and Open Space, would require. That being said, we actually will change our recommendation of denial to an approval. With that, do you have any questions?
Walk us through the site, please.
Sure.
Where are we going to have parking? Where are vehicles going to be stored, et cetera?
So I guess we'll try and describe it. I can also point at the screen if that's better. Along the front, Avenue J. Now, again, this will all have to be worked out, the exact details. But in essence, regulations require a 10-foot landscape strip along Avenue J. So if we can imagine all of Avenue J, 10 feet back, being landscaped. Of course, they need an apron. They need entrance to the site. So there will be a gap wherever that ends up being. There also would be required along all the sides and the back a 6-foot landscape strip. So you can just draw that in. Now, it's important to note, the landscape chapter does allow for an alternative landscape plan, which makes that number, that 6 and that 10, a little flexible. So depending on the site, we'll work with the applicant, both us and Parks, Recreation, and Open Space, to determine what that number will be. But in theory, maybe that number is 5 feet as opposed to 6 feet. Maybe that number is 9 feet as opposed to 10 feet. But they will provide landscaping along the front, along the sides, along the back.
How does a vehicle get from the front door to the rear?
So with the driveway as designed, as is, a vehicle can drive behind. Depending on what sort of landscaping options might go, that driveway could be reduced to the point that no cars can drive. That being said, there's a bay in the front and there is a bay in the rear. The auto facility itself would require 3 parking spaces, which staff feels we can get in the front. What that means is in the rear, since it is sort of a repair facility, in theory they could drive through the building, do whatever repair they need to do in the rear, store whatever cars with work orders they need to store in the rear, and then bring it back out to leave.
And all repairs will be done inside of the building?
Yes, always. That's a condition. So, you know, like we said, we have a plan that does not show where we're ultimately going to be. If there's reservations, completely understand. We are changing our stance only with these conditions.
Thank you, Ash. Yeah. Any questions of Ash, yeah. Commissioners?
Any others? Okay. Thank you.
Any comment, Commissioners? We do want to acknowledge that the applicant is here, does not wish to speak, Mr. Vincent Powell. Thank you, Mr. Powell.
I have a question. Do we have a site plan that shows what the landscaping would look like?
Actually, we do not.
Mm-hmm.
What you do have, I mean, we're sort of in the same place we were in the last application.
Yeah.
Except we're a little further closer to approving because we know what we want and we know what they've agreed to, but we don't have it in a depiction of a site plan at all.
What would be the appropriate request in order to?
Are you suggesting you'd like to see what the site plan would look like with landscape?
I would.
Before you make that motion, I'd like to ask the applicant some questions.
Okay.
Mr. Powell?
And I would like to add that it's my understanding that the property owner is in fact here.
Okay.
And the property owner has said that there will be no improvements made.
Answers that.
Okay.
So we have signed conditions.
Who signed the conditions?
The applicant.
Okay.
Sir, it seems it may be appropriate to give you some time to discuss with the owner how you're going to work this out. We can move forward with our vote today, or I would suggest maybe a continuance to allow you some time to work that out. Now, based on what Ash has just stated.
Okay, I mean, actually, I'm going to meet with him afterwards.
But give us your name if you mail an address, please.
3852 Augustine Circle, Portsmouth, Virginia, 23703. Up until the day, we really didn't... wasn't really clear of what the landscaping. He did a few phone calls back and forth to myself and the owner. Little communication gap in between the three of us. But lately, we've been covering all the upgrades ourselves. Mm-hmm. So once he give us a little bit clear details, we're going to take care of that ourselves. We didn't put any of that on the owner at all. We've been doing it ourselves. Kind of new to this. I didn't know if I can bring PowerPoint or slide. I did a printout of what we was working on. So we're just was waiting for the hearing to move farther with certain things. We didn't want to go too far in advance with things that we wasn't supposed to do or should do without the hearing. We didn't want to jump the gun and then get inspected and it was already there. So it was pretty much waiting to see what we were supposed to do and what we can't do.
Have you shared that with staff?
I met with him today because this is my first time.
Well, you say you had some drawings there?
My a little PowerPoint slide out of because the city council told me to bring handouts that I didn't have before, so I wasn't aware of how to give them out or who to give them to.
Go ahead.
No problem.
Sounds like we need to give you some time to work through this.
Okay, sure.
Okay, so maybe we would entertain an extension for 30 days to see potentially if all the parties to this can work it out, and you can share some of your ideas with staff, and we can get all that stuff in front of us.
Yes, sir.
Okay, is that something you're amenable to?
Yes, sir.
That'll be great. Then we'll entertain a motion to continue this for 30 days, Lenny?
Certainly. The motion's to continue the item till the public hearing to be held on January 22nd, 2015 at 2:30 p.m. in the City Council Chambers, 11th Floor Civic Center, Norfolk, Virginia. Dr. Newman?
Aye.
Ms. McQuillan?
Yes.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Halchins?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Mr. Fraley?
Aye. We look forward to seeing that. Thank you.
All right. The next application before us is Royal Auto Sales for a special exception to operate an automobile sales and service facility, property fronting 129 feet more or less along the northern line of East Virginia Beach Boulevard, beginning 99 feet more or less from the eastern line of Kempsville Road and extending eastwardly. Premises numbered 6210 East Virginia Beach Boulevard.
Chris, thank you.
Yeah, good afternoon. This application is from Royal Auto Sales for a special exception for an automobile sales and service facility at 6210 East Virginia Beach Boulevard. It's located on the north side of East Virginia Beach Boulevard, just east of Kempsville Road at the intersection. It is zoned C2. You've got C2 and C4 on the adjacent properties. It's currently developed with a building. It's about 8,300 square feet. Fairly large building. And there's also a communication tower as well right next to the building. It received a special exception back in, I believe it was 1999, excuse me, for the commercial communication tower. And now it's the new business would be in auto sales and service. Even though the building is 8,300 square feet, they're only proposing to use about 3,400 square feet of the building, so about just the first floor. And as we do with auto repair, auto and truck repair as well, We do have the landscaping requirements, and much like your previous application, the staff has met with the applicant and property owner, and we have proposed a 10-foot landscaping buffer from East Virginia Beach Boulevard in the front, and a 6-foot buffer along the adjacent property lines where the parking lot abuts the adjacent properties. And also, the applicant has met with the Public Works Department, the Transportation Division, and they have also required or recommended that they close one of the streets or one of the driveways on East Virginia Beach Boulevard. So they have agreed to do that as in the proposed site plan. So they have one driveway on East Virginia Beach Boulevard, and then the egress or the exit would be onto Kempsville Road in the rear. So the applicant has also provided us with a landscape plan, which you'll see in your packet, which shows landscaping, as I said, in the 10-foot buffer area on East Virginia Beach Boulevard, as well as 6 feet on the western property line just below the building. And however, on the eastern property line, which abuts the Hendrick Auto property, the applicant has declined to make that landscaping improvement, mainly due to the desired parking spaces that would go on the eastern side of the property there. The applicant does have enough spaces for the building. They're proposing to only use the first floor again, and that requires 13 parking spaces, and the site contains about 17 spaces, so they meet their parking requirement. So staff, with the refusal to do all of the staff's recommendations for the landscaping, staff does recommend denial of this application. We do have attached conditions, however, if the board does want to approve the application, we do have attached conditions that would tie the special exception to the submitted site plan and the landscape plan. And also, we did receive a Civic League letter from the Hollywood Homes Maple Hall Civic League just recently, which is also in your packets. And, you know, if a member of the Civic League is here, they can speak much better to this. But just to give you a couple of brief highlights, they are concerned. It's a unanimous opposition letter. They're concerned about the traffic on East Virginia Beach Boulevard as well as Kempsville Road. They're concerned about that access egress or the ingress egress points on the site. They believe it's too small of a site for that. They're also concerned about just the use itself. They believe there's, you know, according to their letter, they believe there's a proliferation of auto establishments on the corridor. So, and I will, again, I'll let if there's a representative or president of the Civic League here, they can, you know, speak to that much better. And with that, are there any questions?
A couple of questions. Is there currently an occupant on the second floor of this building?
I don't know. It's vacant.
Okay. Is there anticipated that there will be?
I do not know.
Are you the owner of the property, sir?
Well, I own the property, yes. Currently, there's a kitchen.
Excuse me. If you're going to make comment, please come up and give us your name and mailing address and let us know how you're associated with this application.
Thank you. My name is John Harris. I live at 3840 Bay Oaks Place, Norfolk, Virginia, 23518. I represent the owner, who is my father. And I'm also offered to speak for the applicant. This is an older building. It's built as a bank building back in the 60s. The community has evolved. Everything has changed around it. My father took commercial radio, which was over on Collie Avenue for 30 plus years, started by my grandfather, moved over to this building, and hence that's why there's a communications tower. He's retired, sold the building to Gately Communications. No, I'm sorry, sold the business, Gately Communications. They also had an office in Chesapeake and North Carolina, so they moved out a few years ago. Second floor was used for web hosting service, so it just had large rooms, lots of air conditioning that had communications equipment, file servers and stuff like that, and it was also worked off the tower for satellite, which took our local stations and shot it to the West Coast. So, hence, we have all this building and we have this tower. We don't have a specific use for the building. It's old. I brought just a few pictures, if that's okay.
Absolutely.
All right. currently, the
Thank you.
We're completely surrounded. Hendrick, who had an interest in the building, but just to tear it down, and also because the tower is now owned by Crown Castle, they have a lease and you can't take it down until they select it. Anytime Auto also had an interest in it, but the price is a little bit more they want to pay for. They've moved in on both sides. And most of the time, the traffic is coming through the site is Hendrick's employees that cut through to go to their parking. We have met as many as we possibly could of the requirements that have been asked for landscaping. The drawings going through right now is the east side of the property line. There's currently a green area there. We are also doing the large green area at the front by the street. That also helps. But the reason we can't put a 6-foot buffer in there is that we've been reduced down to a 13-foot wide lane that come through the property and then come out on Kinsville Road. So it's no longer two-way. We lost the, which we would have rather kept, the other inlet, which would have made it a lot easier to get on and off the boulevard. So that's kind of a hindrance, so we've taken that. The back of the property, there's a 10-foot easement on it for Hendrick's employees to walk across it. Currently, all Hendrick's cars are parked along the back, and I really have a good picture, but all the way down that old street, Hendrick's employees park along that. So if we were to even look at landscaping in the back, we would not be able to pull around and come out to Kinsville Road. And this just is a shot of where they have a gate for their employees to walk through. As part of the agreement, when they close the street down on the site. What we are also giving up and been asked to, and we're doing it, is we have a wonderful sign out front if you visit the site. 6 foot by 18 foot. I mean, that's a terrific sign. We're having to take it down. We're having to go under the compliance and meet the requirements. You know, we're giving up a lot. We're giving up everything we have to. And this is just a shot that shows the sign. I wanted to say that Hendrick's done a great job with their addition and meeting most of the landscape requirements across the front. They were able to do portions of it at 10 feet and then other portions probably close to 4 or 5 to get the cars parked. And I wanted to show you that as well. probably lastly is, you know, the site now is hardscaped across the front, nice flagpole, lighting on the flagpole, and a lot of the hardscaping has got to come out, and there's expense associated with that as well. And I'll just pass that around. And then, of course, our site. We've done as much as we can. As far as a car dealership, this site has a lot of building and not as much space as you would. If you're a car dealer, you want autos on the lot, you don't want building. So I can just say we've done everything we possibly could to meet the newer guidelines, even though we can't make them all. I felt that we had to get a recommendation denial just because of that 6-foot buffer. But we've met everything else and then have done more so. And I'd be glad to answer any questions.
You are aware, Mr. Harris, that the Civic League was unanimous in there and not in support of this application. Have you met with them?
No, I was not able to meet with them. I was told they were doing their holiday dinner on that particular night when they meet that month. I tried to get hold of them the month before, left several messages. The information I was given, and it's also shown in his letter, that the name that I was given was to someone who was a president who passed away, and their spouse has left the area. Mm-hmm. That phone number does work, and you can leave messages on it, and I did. Mm-hmm. That it was kind of insinuating that I came up with that number. It wasn't. It was provided to us through the planning department. It's not my writing. It was provided on the application. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. I did ask to meet with them at any other time other than the group be glad to go over and meet them on site. Was told that that wouldn't be necessary and that they would be writing their letter and just submit it to the planning staff. Mm-hmm. To me, you know, I've had a little bit of urban planning. You know, I don't agree with spreading everything out. I think car dealerships being left in the same area is a good thing, just like having multiple restaurants in one area is a good thing. If something's full, something doesn't have what you want, you just walk over or pop over to the next one. You don't get in your car and drive 6 or 7 miles to go to the next one. Mm-hmm. This particular property, it's just, if someone else adds 2 more cars to the lots, they're already on top of us. You can't see us from the back. There's a school, and there's also all the Hendricks cars there. Mm-hmm. Can't see us from the right. Hendricks cars are there. Can't see us from the left. You got any time. Mm-hmm. And I, to me, you know, what else are you going to do? Everything around it, well, Hendricks has been there a long, long time, but everything else has changed. You know, could a bank come back in there? Yes, I asked Monarch if they would go in there. They're not interested. Your small banks are, you know, great vault.
Okay. Any questions of Mr. Harris, commissioners?
Yes, I have some questions. We've seen the site. It is a big building for the site. You want to do auto sales and service there. How are you going to retrofit this building to make it work? Because, you know, there's a question, where's your inventory? How are you going to, I can see offices, but how are you going to do service?
The service is really for the vehicles that are being sold on the lot. So if they purchase the vehicles, they bring them in, they do an in-house inspection. It's not a service for people that come in off the road to have oil changes and what for. Theirs is just, it's really a car prep.
I understand that. Okay. I understand that point.
Oh.
Is this to be done indoors? Where are you going to do this?
Oh, in the back, there's a double car commercial garage. It was added on by commercial radio because that's where they put the police, the radios inside the cars for the police, the fire department, and other public utility vehicles. So they're inside. There are 2 large overhead doors that come into the garage from the rear of the building.
Yeah.
The survey shows on the back that they've got, it's in your staff report, that shows a garage area to the north on the back of the building and the 2 bays that he's referring to.
Yeah, it's here.
Any other questions of Mr. Harris?
The applicants here and my father's here, if you also would like to speak.
Yeah, they have signed up in favor of this application, but do not wish to speak.
Oh.
But while you're standing there, Mr. Harris, you are aware you got a couple of things that don't look terribly favorable right now. Let me tell you what they are. This commission has been very, very supportive of neighborhoods and the impact that they feel any particular application, if it's approved or not approved, can have on their community. They come out very strongly against you. The second thing, if we got a denial from the planning staff who does the investigation for us. And as I understand, their denial is based on your failure to want to do some additional landscaping. Now, I'm not suggesting to you one way or the other, but you would have to understand that with those 2 facts in front of us, it is hard for this commission to see favorably beyond that.
Right.
I just want you to be aware of that. Now, if you might want to consider the potential of addressing those 2 issues, this commission considers this application.
Right. Well, the Civic League wouldn't give me a permission to come in there. Mm-hmm. And if you want to table it for next month, I can come out there. I don't know if I'm going to change your mind because they're dead set against auto dealerships. Mm-hmm. All right. Love to do it. I have no problem with it. The six-foot buffer along the right-hand side, and I've provided a shot, a photograph of the landscape that's in there, renders the site not usable as anything as a car dealership because then there's no road to get around. There's such a small road. It's like an alleyway. So you got to look at it. Hey, do I want a business in here, a business-friendly environment? Do I want this building rented where I get revenue off of it, the city gets tax dollars off of it, and those people have jobs? Or do I want to wait until the perfect tenant wants to come along, actually wants that building exactly the way it is with the big sign and all? And I'm here to say, look, I got an opportunity to rent it to someone who could use it. We're doing 99% of what you want. That's, I mean.
Understood. Thank you.
I didn't know how to sign that paper.
Are you done, sir?
Oh, yes, sir.
Thank you.
Uh-huh.
Mr. Harris, we will afford you the opportunity to speak.
Thank you.
You want to come up to the podium, give us a name and mail and address, sir?
My name is John Harris.
I was born and raised in this city. I had business in this city.
Your mailing address, sir?
Oh, gosh. My mailing address is 9618 Bay Point Drive in East Beach area of Norfolk, the new East Beach area of Norfolk. I've had a business in, I've had several businesses in Norfolk. I had one on Collie Avenue for 30 years. I have one in 6210 for 20 years. And of course, finally got too old to do much more things. I'm 76 years old. I need a little revenue coming in. But anyway, we try to be good citizens of our community. Mm-hmm. And Lenny would tell you that I fussed at him a lot, but I didn't really.
It's all good.
Good time. We would appreciate some help from you guys to help us keep going and doing this. It, the building's been vacant for 3 years. It's what do you do with it? I don't know. And talking with the, tell me.
Civic League?
Civic League. Behind us is of course, the Cadillac place too, all the way back. And then we have a school back there. Civic League got to be way back there, and we have no exit entrance to go to a city, to a street deck there. There's a street on the other side of Henry. So why are they complaining with us? And it's all cars. Anyway, all we're going to do is get a few more feet of cars, and I don't know, and we put somebody to work and whatever. If I can answer any questions, I try to think about if I could do it. But let me know, and I'll be glad to answer questions.
Thank you, Mr. Harris. Any questions of Mr. Harris, Commissioner? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any comment, Commissioners?
My only comment is, you know, recently this commission and staff has worked hard and come up with a new set of guidelines to try to limit the very small, unsightly used car dealerships. And I think because of the size of the building on this particular lot, it may just be that this is not a great particular place for a used car sales. I don't know that I intend on voting in favor of this.
Thank you, Martin. Any other commission comments? Lenny?
The motions recommend that the special exception be approved subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Dr. Newman?
No.
Ms. McQuillan?
No.
Ms. Austin?
No.
Mr. Helchins?
Do I understand you said subject to the conditions that were proposed by staff?
Yeah, you know, I will always read a positive recommendation, and I will always condition it to what we have recommended in our staff report. And I will alter that depending on the outcome of your discussion. But we always present you a positive recommendation if you support that, then you vote in favor. If you oppose it, you vote no. And if you wish that it be altered, then that comes out of the discussion.
But do I understand clearly that they have disagreed with the proposal that you've given?
That's correct. Mm-hmm.
And your vote is?
Nay.
Okay. Mr. Thomas?
No.
Mr. Fraley?
No. We'll make that recommendation to council. Wish you luck. Thank you so much. Before we proceed, I had a request. Ms. Hyman, are you good? I think we might want to take a 5-minute break.
You want to keep going?
Okay. You ready to proceed? All right, unless somebody else needs a break, we're proceeding. Okay, go ahead.
What she's saying is if you hurry up and finish the next three.
That's what she's saying, right?
The next application before you is Cuisine at Slover, special exception operating eating and drinking establishment on property fronting 181 feet more or less along the southern line of East Plume Street and 162 feet more or less along the western line of Atlantic Street, premises number 235 East Plume. And you'll recall from your presentations earlier, this is a eating and drinking establishment being operated in consort with the brand new Slover Library.
And I note that we have no opposition.
Motions recommend that the special exception be approved subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Dr. Newman?
Aye.
Ms. McQuillan?
Can't wait to go there. Yes, aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Houchins? Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Sorry. Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Mr. Fraley?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation. Council, look forward to it already.
Next application is the Jose Tequila Mexican Grill for a special exception operate eating and drinking establishment on property fronting 180 feet, more or less along the northern line of East Little Creek Road and 175 feet, more or less on the western line of Lyon Avenue, premises numbered 1108 East Little Creek Road.
And we do want to acknowledge Gene Tursic. Turk does not wish to speak, but is here in favor of this application. Other than that, there is no opposition.
The motions recommend that the special exception be approved subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Dr. Newman?
Aye.
Ms. McQuillan?
I'll have to try that one out, too. Aye.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Mr. Fraley?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation to council. Good luck.
Next application before you is the Barrel Room for a special exception to operate entertainment establishment with alcoholic beverages on property fronting 25 feet more or less along the western line of Granby Street and 26 feet more or less along the eastern line of Greens Court, premises numbered 437 Granby Street.
And we have in favor of this application but do not wish to speak Michael Lindenworth and Angel Velasquez. And pardon me? Other than that, no opposition.
Motions recommend to you that the special exception be granted subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Dr. Newman?
Aye.
Ms. McQuillan?
Yes.
Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Houchins?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Mr. Fraley?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation to council. That concludes our agenda. Mr. Holmes.